of Homa. How y'all doing this morning? Well, we want to wish you amazing, wonderful fathers. Happy Father's Day. We hope you have an awesome day today. But are y'all ready to worship our wonderful and magnificent God today? Yes. Come on.
You've brought me to the water where my past can be swept away. In the covering of your mercy, and I know I'll never be the same. There's no limit to your promise, Jesus, you have done it all for me. Jesus, you have done it all for me.
Thank you for your grace that sweeps over us like a wave. Father, we just pray that your spirit would just sweep through this room and just bring forth healing, restoration. God, to change our minds and our hearts. Father, we just pray your spirit would break out in this place.
You're the name we're lifting high, your glory.
As I walk now through the valley, let your love rise above every fear. Like the sun shaping shadow in my weakness, your glory.
Not for a minute was I
bless you come. Will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is all you are. Will you meet me here again? Not enough, not enough. Let you come. Will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is all you are. Will you meet me here again?
Thank you, Jesus, for letting us have this day to worship you as our Father of all fathers. We give you thanks on this wonderful Father's Day that we get a chance to share in your love. And your worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yes. Come on. Well, I'd like to say welcome to all of y'all this morning that came today. If y'all don't mind, could y'all please be seated? As we prepare for tithes and offerings, this is the moment of the church where we take that up. If it's your first time here, this is not for you, but if you feel led, please do so. Just want y'all to know that these tithes and offerings, some of you may be thinking, what are they being used for? All right, we don't just use it for stuff at the church. We reach multitudes of people across the world. We want these funds to reach out like God's hands reaches out to each and every one of us. We want this money to reach out and touch everybody's lives, not just here, right? I don't know, some of y'all may not see behind the scenes, but we are doing a lot of modifications here at the church. The pastor's coming in here on his weeks off, and he's putting in hours of work. So, you know, just keep that in mind. You know, we want to build this church together, right? We want to continue to watch it flourish. We want to also continue to be thankful of what he's given us so that we have the opportunity to give back, right? And show our love through these tithes and offerings to others that he showed to us. So as y'all are preparing, I'm going to go ahead and pray over this. And man, y'all just put it on your heart and just think, what do you want me to give? And he'll let you know. He'll help you out. All right? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you right now, Lord, for this tithes and offerings that we're about to receive, Lord, that it not just only watch over us, Lord, that it flourishes this world, Lord, that this money, it reaches out to every country out there, Lord, in some form or fashion, Lord, that we just continue to help one another, Lord. We help build our community up. Continue to build this church up, Lord. Continue to build the faith in these people and faith in our hearts, Lord. We just thank you and we give you all praise, honor, and glory. Amen.
Welcome to Victor Roma. We're so glad you're here with us this morning. If you're a guest, please fill out a Connect card, which is located behind your chair. If you have any kids, please check them into VK Kids, which is located behind the main stage. Stay tuned for the rest of the news. Good morning, everyone. Life is better in circles, not rows. God created us to be in community with each other, and it's so important for you to find a small group where you can share your heart and have people that are like-minded and that can relate to you. We are having our summer launch day on Sunday, June 28th. It's gonna be before and after service, and leaders are gonna be available in the foyer to answer any of your questions. Also, if you're interested in starting a group, just come and find me and we can set up a meeting so we can discuss what are your options of being a leader. It's so life-changing to become a leader. Thank you, guys. That's it for the news, guys. Make sure to follow us on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and Twitter. Thank you so much. Yo, guys, have a great day.
Happy Father's Day, Daddy.
Happy Father's Day. Love you, Dad.
Happy Father's Day, Daddy. Love you. You're the best in the whole world.
Happy Father's Day, Daddy. Love you.
He forgot to give us food one time.
Happy Father's Day, Dad. I love you.
Just want to say Happy Father's Day. And the craziest thing he ever did was when I was a teenager, I wanted to wear shirts that showed my belly and stuff, and he said that he was gonna take me in Walmart and put his shirt like through the top, and he would show off all his belly, and he'd walk around holding my hand. If I wanted to do that, then he was gonna do it too.
My dad is a super dad. He's a hard worker. He lifts heavy weights for his bodybuilding competitions. Now that's crazy. Love you, Daddy. Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day, Dad. Thank you for always being there for me and for teaching me to be the strong mother I am today.
Hey, Mr. Kinney, also known as Dad, thank you so much for everything that you do for us. You are the greatest. Thank you for stepping up and being a father figure to us. Also, thank you for dealing with my high school days and letting us borrow tools out the garage, although we don't always bring them back in time or when we finish with them. Also, thank you for considering me to be the greatest daughter and the most favorite child. Whoops, did I say that out loud? Just kidding. Happy Father's Day. Love you.
Hey, Dad. Happy Father's Day. I just wanted to say thanks for everything, really, and just always being there for me and seeing the good in me and believing in me when I couldn't, and just being my rock and the coolest dad I could ever ask for. Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day.
Hey, Mr. Kinney. Just coming on to say Happy Father's Day and thank you for being a good role model to us and our children and being the dad that literally we never had. Just want to thank you for that. We love you forever. And also, I want to wish Jordan a Happy Father's Day. I know you're not Asher's dad, and I'm hiding from you while you're in the bathroom, so I hope you can't hear me right now, but I want to thank you for stepping up and being somebody he can look up to as well. I want to thank y'all and love y'all so much.
I'm telling you, please put on your shoes. Shoes!
Where's Grandma?
She's inside, mi amor.
Carrington, you know not to run in the house!
Got your hands full.
I love her, but she's really been pushing my buttons.
I want to show you something. Open it.
Are these?
Yep.
So these are all the times I pushed your buttons.
Oh, heck no. There's not a garage big enough to hold that. No, these are the special ones.
How did you put up with me?
I learned to translate the signals.
Huh.
Once you got yourself a personality, you got really good at pressing my buttons. Drove me nuts. Most times you were just being a kid figuring out life. Like the time you called me up in the middle of the night to pick you up from summer camp. Yeah, I'm ashamed to admit that it took so long, but that's when I understood that you weren't trying to frustrate me. Sometimes you were pushing my buttons because you were just homesick or scared or lonely or confused or sad. Once I understood the signals, I learned how to appreciate the buttons. Learn our language. Understand the signals. Meet her there.
That sounds hard.
That's the job, son.
Ted, this one's from last week.
Yes, it was.
Yeah. All right. So, well, with that being said, happy Father's Day to all you fathers out there. As a matter of fact, you know, let's give our father a good, cheerful, happy Father's Day. You know, because, man, without him, where would we be, right? And just like that, y'all know how many times we pushed his button? Think about it. But actually, I want to do something right quick. For all the fathers in there, you know, since dad jokes are dad jokes, I know that some of these dads out here can get some of these little jokes correct this morning, you know. Just, you know, all right, I don't trust stairs. Anybody? Nobody? All right, because they're always up to something. Okay? Did you hear the rumor about the butter? I'm not going to spread it. What time did the man go to the dentist? Come on, Pastor Ken, I know you know this one. No? Not today? 2:30. You know, but with that being said, you know, just keep in mind of the dads that y'all have, you know, and I'm just so thankful to see all these fathers in here today with their families, right? Because I forgot what the statistics is, but when the father figure in the household goes to church, it's so overwhelmingly high percentage that the rest of the family will follow. So I thank all you fathers out there right now. Thank y'all for doing what y'all do. Ooh. All right. But another thing, for you dads out there, if y'all could just stand up. Come on. You two, stand up. You know, we here at Victory, we love each and every one of you. And today, we have a special gift for all of you fathers out there. And it's so great to get something on Father's Day, right? A fishing trip would be nice. But, you know, so as we get ready, yep, I'll take mine. Did somebody get Mr. Tillman in the back corner over here? He might be hiding, but I'm short. I can see everybody where I'm standing. But once again, thank y'all for being the dads that y'all are. and just continue to do the great job in life. So with that being said, I get the honors of introducing y'all guest speaker today, even though he's really a great guy. So with all other ado, Mr. Adam Petroya.
Is this thing on? Oh, Adam Petroya Senior now. How about that? How is everybody today? Man, every time. How is everybody today? Today is a day that the Lord has made. I'm going to rejoice and be glad in it. You know, along with the gift that we give you, I'm going to give you, I don't know what's in it, but I'm going to tell you that the gift I have for you guys is even better. I'm going to give you a short message. Daz, look, I'm telling you, it's going to be super short. It's 10:35. Y'all going to be out of here in 15 minutes. Off the call, everything's going to be done. It really will be short. Now, happy Father's Day, but before I get too much into Father's Day, sadly, I don't have any LSU news to report, because every time I speak, you know, LSU, not that LSU's first, it's fourth in the God Family Church LSU, but I like to bring it up first. I really do appreciate this opportunity. I got to be transparent. Y'all, I have an overwhelming feeling of the Holy Spirit right now. Whew. It's amazing. And the reason I needed it is because I had the busiest, most hectic, hasty last few weeks. I mean, that's, y'all see, I'm not up here for worship. I can't physically do everything right now. And this message, somebody has to hear this message, because I've had more resistance than ever, than I can remember. From one thing is I was already kind of falling behind, and I lost my entire message last Sunday before I started having a chance to write it down. I was fixing to write it down when I lost it. Lost my whole phone. It was in my phone. Now, when I got my new phone on Tuesday, every single one of my apps came back. Everything in every one of my apps came back, except for what? Except for Memo that message was in. I don't think that's an accident. Once again, I'm OCD. I've never been clinically diagnosed being OCD, but I do have to have things in order. I mean, everything has to be a certain way. My wife can attest to that, because she is not. But my little girl is, so I got a fighting chance. I'm one of those people. Everything has to be in order. I have to be prepared. I mean, I'll give you an example, like grocery store. I'll take the grocery list that's all over the place. I'll rewrite it in order of the way the things are in the store. And then I bag it a certain way. I put it on the belt a certain way. Somebody wants to put my bags in for me, I'm like, no, I got it, because I put it in my truck a certain way. I mean, that's just how I am. My wife is not. But that being said, you know, I was not prepared. Oh, well, I was fixing to be prepared to do this message. So when I tell y'all that this is going to be straight Holy Spirit, it has no other chance but to be Holy Spirit. Which is the best way, right? It is the best way. And before I get too far into us as fathers, you know, beginning of this, we're going to talk about Father's Day and men. But can, like Joe, can we give God a happy Father's Day? Come on, man. I don't need Maury Povich or Jerry Springer to tell me Jesus is the father of all y'all bad kids. And I stress the bad kids part. And once again, before I start, I've got to say this. If you've been here in the last couple weeks, or you've been watching online, where's the camera? The last two series, and if you're not closer to God, or you don't feel like you're being fed, it's not because the food is not here. Brother Kenny, you've been on it, brother. Come on, y'all. Can y'all let them know how he's been doing as your pastor? I've got to say it, man. You have been on it. And enemy has no chance. Look. But no, look, y'all, don't forget to let your pastor know how he's doing. I mean, as a pastor, the enemy knows who you are. The enemy knows who Kenny Hobbs is, and he's going to try to discourage him. Don't think he doesn't need encouragement. You've been tearing it up, brother. And as a teacher myself, I know you've been in tune with the Holy Spirit. And I just want to thank you because, you know, as, even though you preach for 3 hours sometimes, I love it, man. This one will not be 3 hours. Melissa, we all know who really does it, and that's you. No, but thank you for being who you are because you guys are a great team. You can't do it by yourself, and I'm glad you're there. And guys, don't forget to pray for your pastors. Don't forget to pray for your pastors. All right, back to Father's Day. After I get a sip of water. Although Joe told some horrible Father's Day jokes, I think I'm going to top it right here. All right, this is a little longer, though. Y'all stay with me. There was a father who had 5 kids. He came home with a toy. He called out to all of his kids, told them to come in the living room, and he asked, which one of you should be given this toy? You know, which one of you is worthy? Who is the most obedient one here who never talks back to your mom, who does everything she says? Well, the kids kind of grouped up, and they looked at the dad and said, all right, Dad, you can play with it. And as now that I have kids, that's true. And, of course, I had to shout out to the moms because, you know, as dads, we can't have nothing, right? Do you have anything that's yours, really yours? You don't. I'm going to tell you right now. You don't. Food, clothes, your spot. Don't act like y'all don't want and have y'all spot at y'all house. Thank you. And then, you know, you come in from outside and you walk inside and you give them that look, that stank face, like, no, I'm by myself? Because they know they're in your spot. And then they look at you like nothing, like, what? What? Look, we don't ask for much. Just give us our spot. Y'all welcome, man. That's my spot, babe. I only have 2 spots, the chair right here and then the end of this sofa. Stay out. But that's what we do, man. There's a good chance that if you're a good dad, you have a little bit of selflessness in you. Fortunately for myself, I had the best example of a selfless. I'll be back with y'all. I had the best example of a selfless man, and that was my stepfather who raised me. Now, at 5 years old, my parents divorced. So right there, I should have became a statistic, right? That's not how God works. God put a man in my life that although he couldn't do everything with me, he provided for me, and he showed me what it meant to be a selfless. There was never another person as selfless as this guy. So I have a hard time saying I come from a broken home. I think I come from a fixed home because God provides. It's been over 8 years now that he's gone, but never forgot. Dads, I hope y'all realize how critical y'all are to your families. I'll give you a few stats. Now, homes without a father produce these facts. Your kids have a 4 times more chance of living in poverty. A 7 times more likely to become pregnant as a teen. Twice as likely to drop out of high school. 71% of high school dropouts come from a fatherless home. They have a 279% higher chance of carrying guns and dealing drugs. That's not important, right? Come on, man. 63% of youth suicides come from fatherless homes. 90% of runaways come from fatherless homes. Louisiana ranks 2nd in the nation for having single mother homes. The father is missing in these homes, right? It's because the father is missing in the father. And as men of God, you're the head of the household. I didn't make that up. That's biblical. But also as men of God, it's time to stop telling your kids how to do life and start living it and let them watch. You need to be the example, guys. It's time to step up. Look, James 1:22 says, do not merely listen to the word and deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Guys, that's not hard. That's not like you have to go through a series of puzzles to understand what that means. 1 Corinthians 16:13, be watchful, stand firm in faith, act like men, be strong. Act like men. Love your wives. You know, I couldn't pronounce the guy's name, so I'll say someone said, the most important thing a father can do for his children is to love their mother. You know, as a father, you have to be a lot of things for your kids. You will. I'm learning all that, guys. Look, my little girl's 4, my boy's 4 months. You're going to have to be a lot of things, but the most important thing you have to be is there. You have to be there. Look, that truck, those clothes, the games and stuff like that, that's not as important as you being there. And material things aren't going to replace you either. You can't be replaced. The dad has to be there. They cannot take your place. I don't think anybody probably in this church understands that more than Pastor Kenny with the Truth and Nature program. Man, that Truth and Nature program, if you don't know, they take fatherless boys, guys that just don't have that father figure, and they become that for them. Amen. That's nothing short of amazing. Yeah. Don't let anybody tell you anything else. That is amazing, guys. Can we give them a hand? To make an impact on somebody's life, that's what a Christian should be. I don't care what you read and what religion tells you what a Christian should be. Make an impact, a positive impact on people's lives. That's what we're here for. We're not just here for us. And thank y'all for getting that. All right, kids. Y'all need to honor y'all dads and y'all parents in general. Why? Because they know more than you think. All right. Is there any like kid parents in the same room right now? All right. Kids, look at your parent. If there's a kid in here, look at your parent and just let them know that you do not always know the right way to do everything. Say it respectfully, because I'm not responsible for the dots on your head. So look at them, let them know you don't always know the right way to do everything, your mom or your dad. Now, dad, parent, whoever it is, look back at your kid and say, I might not always know the right way, but I know your way is wrong. From experience. God, does experience mean something? I'm starting to experience that. All right. 6 years and 1 week ago, I went on a date with a girl. 6 years and 1 week ago, because last week was 6 years, and it is that smoking hot woman in the second row. Yes. Point. But no, man, look, it's amazing that was 6 years ago. And the funny thing is, I was happy before that day. I was happy before I met Julia. But now I'm full. I'm just complete now. I have 2 beautiful children. I'm complete now, man. It was 6 years and a week ago. You know, when I became a husband and a father, all my what ifs or what could have beens or wondering if I missed out on something, that all went away. It did, because I'm full. Now, what am I full of? Don't answer that. Because all y'all just cursed in y'all head. No, but I'm going to tell y'all, I'm full of joy. I have a peace beyond all understanding. And I would further explain peace beyond all understanding, but I don't think y'all would understand it. Because that's... All right, y'all gonna get that later. You know, as a father, I love being able to provide, you know, shelter and necessities for my kids. My little girl Celia, my boy's Adam, for those that don't know. You know, I love buying her things and watching her face light up, stuff that I know she's gonna love. I mean, I can't wait to give it to her, and I do, and this little girl appreciates things, man, and she just lights up. But the thing that I pray, man, the thing that I strive for is just the most important thing is, she's got to know she's loved. He already knows he's loved. But I'm saying they have to know that they're loved. And they know that. You know, that's what I strive for. They need to know the love of the Father and the love of the Father. If we do that, guys, those statistics are going to go down. I'm almost done with the Father part. For y'all women that's doing like this, like, you know, chewing gum and whatnot. Guys, your children need you to be strong. It's not always easy. This kingdom needs you to be strong. Sometimes that's extremely difficult. It is. But it's in our reach. We have the Holy Spirit as our helper. I'm so glad I'm not in the world. I'm so glad I know Jesus because I need that help. I need the Holy Spirit. I needed that Holy Spirit this week more than ever. And he's with me right now. Though we try to be, you know, perfection is an unreachable goal. It's an unattainable goal. You will fail sometimes. You're going to get angry sometimes. It doesn't say you need to be the perfect man. You know, Jesus was perfect. Blameless. Not one sin ever. Can y'all imagine that? I mean, I sinned 10 times since I've been up here, probably. I don't know. I'm just saying that the guy's never sinned, not one sin in his life. We can't fathom that. We never will. But what if I told you that, in my opinion, because my opinion is this big, but I'm on the stage right now. What if I told you that Jesus got angry sometimes? What if I told you that Jesus got frustrated? Now, he's doing the will of the Father, so if he's doing the will of the Father, there's no such thing as sin. Flipping table sound familiar to anybody? All right, so Matthew 21, 12, and 13 says, Jesus entered the temple, driving out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. Now, guys, this happened more than once. Now, when I read, a lot of times I like to put myself in that situation. I know Jesus didn't walk in and go, flip the table, drive people out like this. Excuse me, could you come out? You're doing wrong. This is not a den of thieves. Can you get out? That's not what Jesus did. I bet you Jesus went in there and was flipping tables like the Incredible Hulk and kicking people out. You know, in one of the Gospels, didn't it say he made a whip out of cord? I bet he didn't just look pointed at people. I bet he was knocking people, getting them out. What I'm saying is Jesus, he showed anger. Guys, that's our nature. We're going to get angry. I don't get angry often. I don't. But what I'm saying, that I think we try to think of the perfect part. I think our view is off. First of all, the being there part is what needs to happen. You're going to fail, but if you're there, you're failing with them. You know what I mean? The worst thing you could do is never be there. And I know some of us have no choice. You have to provide for your family. Some of our jobs take us away. You know, I do jobs out of town sometimes. Thank you, Jesus. It's been a little while. And the last one I did, I was out for maybe a week, a couple days at a time during the week. But when you are able to be there, they need you, man. They need you. They need you to be that father. So, let's see. All right, this is the most important part, guys. And I'm almost done, like I said a little while ago with the Father's Day part. But this time, I'm really almost done. Please, look, all jokes, I know I joke a lot, but all serious, this is serious. Please listen up and believe what I'm saying. Please don't walk out of here and say, oh man, that was good. Please listen to what I'm saying right now. If you are a father, and if you're online, and maybe you don't think you've been setting the best example, if you think you have failed, if you feel inadequate, guys, you have to hear me. It is not too late. Start right now. You can start today. Let today be the first day of the fresh book of the new you. Now, you won't be able to just wave a magic wand and everything's going to be perfect. We all know better than that. It might take a little work. It might take a lot of work. You might have to work on it for the rest of your life. But can I tell you that it's worth it? It's going to be worth it. Even if you think you failed to this point, you can start now. You know, I look at my little boy right there, and I can't look at him too much right now because I'm going to cry. But, guys, these kids need us. These kids need us. You know, there's so many times where the father's absent, and when the father's absent, there's things that a mother just can't do for him. Just like mothers do things that I just can't do, and I can attest to that. There's no way I can stay home with that little dude all day. My wife is going to heaven. That's a guarantee. I was ready to put him on eBay the other day. Oh, yeah. And not one of these, like, bid things. Buy now. But no, that's a lie. Well, look, guys, man, happy Father's Day. I want to stress that I'm trying to think of how to word it because I didn't write it down, but it's not some kind of puzzle we have to unlock. We just have to be men of God. If we put God first, all this stuff is going to happen. These stats are going to go away. I hope one day there's not a need for the Truth in Nature program. Right? All right. Now for my message. All right, I lied to y'all about the time. You have a choice, part two. Now, I did the first half of this, I think it was April 5th. We were all quarantining, and so if you heard this, it was at your house. So I'm going to just quickly go over a few of the choices that we had. It won't take long. All right. So the first one was, before I do that, I'm going to retell you what the definition of choice. Choice is the act of choosing, the act of picking or deciding between two or more possibilities, the opportunity or power to choose between two or more possibilities. Like I did in April, I'm going to stress the power part. I'm going to emphasize because God gave you the power to choose. Now, your choices are going to affect you and others forever. God, that power of choice it's powerful. We talked about having the choice of watching our tongue. And I said, we don't always need to say the things that we say, right? You know, the tongue's so small, it's the most powerful tool we'll possess. Your tongue, our words can tear somebody down or build somebody up in a matter of seconds. And that effect can last forever. Be careful with that power. We also talked about being judgmental as being a choice. We're quick to judge or label somebody. And I'm guilty of that. I always have. I said it when I preached this last time. I was like, I probably don't go a whole day without unfairly judging somebody. It's my nature, but you know what? I feel like I'm doing a better job of shutting it down when it's happening. It wants to happen. I'm like, oh, no, man, what are you doing? I try to do that. Once again, I'm not perfect. Just remember that not everything you see and hear is what it seems. All right, I'm not going to go into that because we're going to be here for a Pastor Kenny amount of time. I'm sorry, but I have to. We talked about giving up being a choice, and I'll stress it again. Don't let what others say discourage you. Let them think you're crazy. They don't know the whole story, and they don't know what your God can do. We put too much merit on other people's opinions. And if you remember from last time, if you was able to see it, remember how I talked about an opinion. The problem with our opinion is it's based on our life experience. Our life experience is just one of billions. So really, what is your opinion? Now, your opinion is based on your life experience. There's so many other life experiences. You know, the older I get, the more I realize I don't know anything. Honestly, there's so much more than I know. My little thing is this big. There's a whole world around me with different experiences. So, you know, when people ask me my opinion, I'm quick to say, look, this is my opinion. But, you know, don't put that much merit on it. This is just what I think from my little spot on the world. All right. Lastly, I talked about having the choice of leaning on my own understanding or trusting God. And then with that was when I gave the story, which was the first time pretty much anybody in the church heard the story when Adam was born. And I'm not going to get deep into that because I'm going to start crying again. But my son was born. He could not breathe. He could not breathe on his own. So I'll give you the Cliff Notes version. There was a moment in that time, and if you heard the last time, you know what I'm talking about. But I had to make a choice. And we chose to trust God. And look out, he's right there. He's right there. You know, one minute they were reviving him, keeping him alive, and now he's right here listening to his dad speak. So you can't tell me there's no God. You can't tell me God doesn't love me, man. He gave me my wife. I guess I need some points. I don't know. Okay, maybe that's for to store up for later. So I plan on doing something wrong. Anyway, y'all ready for some new choices? Guess not. Okay, well, let's go home. Well, look, it's probably raining. Y'all ready for some new choices? All right. Let's stay dry for a little while and listen to me run my mouth, and then we'll go. All right. This one is important to me, and that is you have the choice to worship freely. Guys, take a step out in faith and freely worship God. To my knowledge, Pastor Kenny has never stopped anybody from worshiping. I've never gone up to somebody during worship and saying, hey, can you calm it down? Has he done it? I don't want to lie to nobody. All right. So to my knowledge, he's never done that. He's never stopped anybody from expressing their love for God. Worship is an outward expression of what's on the inside. Look, I know a lot of you have a lot more joy on the inside than what y'all putting on when y'all putting out. I know that. And I'm not telling you how to do it, but I'm pretty sure some of y'all have more joy than. And look, God gave it. When Danielle started singing, y'all can't tell me y'all don't feel this anointing that just comes in this place. So it's not like you don't have the tools there. And, she's like, spirit break out, whatever. And people's like, yeah, Jesus died for me. Yay. I'm free. Yay. I'm sorry if that hurts somebody's feelings, and it's not meant to. It's just meant, what I'm trying to say is, when you start to outwardly, freely worship the Father, the one who sent his only Son to die for you, we can't express how big that is. When you start freely worshiping God, your life is going to change. I've said that this is the third time I've preached that, and I still believe it. Your life changes because there's something about it. Look, lifting your hands is just a sign of surrender. I don't care what you did. I don't care if you're only here because your wife or girlfriend makes you come, or the opposite. Try worshiping God. Some amazing stuff's going to happen. And look, it doesn't matter what other people think. The last thing, I can't say that because once again, my opinion is this big. But the last thing I think people would get home, I think I can't see them like eating lunch and being like, so-and-so raised one of their hands today. I don't think that happens. Look. Free yourself. The first time I raised my hands, look, I felt weird. I felt super weird because a lot of people around me were doing it, and I had my hands like this. And I'm like, oh, y'all weird, boy. What are y'all doing? You know what I mean? Like, they're doing the wave, and I did it, it came back down. But when I finally did it, man, and I realized that I was just saying, God, you are so big, you are so awesome, you can do all things, I surrender to you. I can't do it on my own. When I did that for the first time, friend, it's really like a weight just went, whew. And I know people struggle with that. But, you know, that's why whenever we were doing the live stream at home, I told people to do it then. You're at your house. You know, just try it out. All right, that's enough. I'm going to preach about that another time. All right, the next choice is you have the choice to encourage or to be encouraging. Now, this choice goes hand in hand with watching your tongue, but it takes it a step further. Watching your tongue is to stop tearing people down. Encouragement is what builds other people. If you know somebody has been struggling for a long time and you see them doing better and you know they're putting work, let them know they're doing better and that you appreciate that work. Let them know that you believe in them. Let them know that they have to keep going and that you, hey, look, man, I see you. Just let them know you see them. I see the effort you're putting in. It's amazing what some encouraging will do. Just like discouraging can get people. It all depends on what season you're in your life. It all depends on what mood you're in that day. But you never know sometimes what a, hey, man, looks like you're doing good. That might bring somebody up. You might just make the next president. Either y'all believe that or y'all not listening. But no, man, look, just tell them that God loves them and that they can keep going. Be fans of each other. How about that? Be fans of each other. Stop being spiteful. Quit hating on people. I'm going to tell y'all a little story because I am a deem myself a hater. I'm typically not, but it was a few weeks ago, and it's a Friday morning. I'm heading to work, and I pull up to my neighborhood to take a left to leave, and two boats with trucks pass me while I'm heading to work. I was not a fan of those guys right there. Matter of fact, I felt myself saying, man, I hope they get a flat. I'm not joking. I hope this boat gets a flat, spins out, this truck hits that boat, and they both on the side of the road and can't go fishing. I got some demons, y'all. That's a lie. I don't have no demons. But I'm just saying, I need to work on myself, because right away I was like, Man, I need to be happy them dudes are going fishing, but I still can't do it. I can't be happy somebody's going fishing when I'm working. But no, we need to be fans of each other, man. Look, if somebody's been fortunate, been thrown a few more breaks than you, man, be happy for them. Be happy for them. Teddy Roosevelt, stop comparing yourself to him, okay? I've said this before. Teddy Roosevelt said it best. The comparison is the thief of joy. And I think Stephen Furtick said also the best was, don't compare your day-to-day to somebody's highlight reel. You know, I know people that they get down because we all go through seasons, guys. We just need God in all those seasons. But you and let's just say you're in one of the down seasons, and boy, first thing people do is they pull up social media. Man, they're looking at how happy people are. That's the highlight reel. I wish social media would have a button that you could press and it goes from highlight reel to blooper reel. Because then you start feeling better about yourself, right? You'd be like, man, I don't have it that bad. Man, I feel good. You know, like, it doesn't have, I don't think it has that button. I don't hang out on that too much no more. But 2 Corinthians 10:12 says, each one should test his own actions. Then he can take pride in himself without comparing himself to somebody else. For each one should carry his own load. If you're going to compare yourself to Jesus' character. Don't compare yourself or be jealous of somebody. You know, there's people that sit back in like in a little cave, boy, and they're like, man, I should have that. They don't deserve that. I do. Why not me? I feel like, I mean, I would do a better job than them. You know, think about it. Are you humble? Are you humble? You know, humbleness, being humble goes a long way in God's eyes, y'all. Humility goes a long way in the eyes of God. James 4:6 says, God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. So maybe the reason that person is shown that grace is because they are humble. Matthew 23:12 says, for whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted. So maybe somebody that you're trying to, you know, you're secretly hating on that has something, maybe it's because they're humble. I know y'all think I got away from the being encouragement, but if you humble yourself, it's going to be a lot easier to encourage people. Now, I'm going to tie another one in with this, and that is you have the choice of who you surround yourself with. Who you surround yourself with plays a giant role in being encouraging and being humble. Bad company corrupts good character. How many of y'all have heard that? How many of y'all, especially if you're a little bit more elevated in age, know that that is a true statement? Character is the mental or moral qualities distinctive to an individual. Now, it's important, young people, it's important to be an individual. It really is. You have to be you. But remember, you wasn't made to do this life by yourself. So surround yourself with life-giving people. Take advice. You know, be teachable. Learn from elders. But, and this is something that I felt like when I was writing this out, God stopped me and said, how about you say this too? Be careful who you let mentor you. Just be careful. Because trust me, look, I think back to some of my first messages I preached. Now, that's 20 years ago. That seems so weird saying that I preached a message 20 years ago. Because I'm like 21 right now. So I guess I was one. So, I think about some of the messages, and I look, some of these are recorded somewhere, and I hope that burned somewhere or got lost or thrown away. Because some of the stuff I was saying, I don't believe anymore. What I'm saying is even though I had good intentions, I wasn't ready to be speaking. Now, I stepped up because I needed to at times, but I wasn't ready to lead others. I still needed some work. Imagine it like this, like babysitting, like kids. A child becomes a certain age where they don't necessarily need a babysitter anymore, right? But they're also not necessarily ready to babysit. So though somebody may not need to be babysat, they're not quite ready to babysit. Make sense? What it means is you might be able to be responsible for yourself, but you're not ready to be responsible for others. And I'm not trying to discourage anybody right now. What I'm saying is just remember, when you're looking for somebody to learn from, when you go to somebody with a problem, just make sure that Jesus is the center of their life. Because I've given some bad advice, and I've got some bad advice, because I went to the wrong people. But one thing, I'm not discouraging anybody. Look, if you need help with something, how about this? If somebody comes to you and you don't feel adequate, find somebody that can. There's sometimes people ask me questions I don't know. Guess what I do? I go to the next person. Somebody that's, you know, has more. And that's why the church is the body. You know, if I don't know something, I'll ask Kenny. If Kenny, I'll ask Danielle. I'll ask somebody else. Somebody else knows. You know, if a woman comes up to me and starts talking about woman stuff, get up. I don't know nothing about that. I might ask Julia to help me. Anyway, I'm going to stop. All right. This is the last one as far as choices go. But it's the most important choice you'll ever make. And I'm almost finished my water, so I can't go too much longer. I don't know what that's for, man. No, that's coronavirus water. All right. Now, this is, you have a choice to follow Christ. In John 8:12, Jesus says, I am. You know, I can stop right there. I am. He is, y'all. I'm gonna keep going. He says, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have light of life. Whoever follows me, Jesus, not a person, not a religion, not a thing. Whoever follows Jesus shall live in the light. Now, look, you need the Bible. You need the Ten Commandments. You need to be a good person. But alone, those things wasn't enough. You need Jesus. There's no substitute for Jesus, guys. All those things that you need. You know, without Jesus, there's no chance of redemption. Without Jesus, there's no truth. Without Jesus, there's no salvation. Jesus is where we have to get back to. You know, if Jesus isn't in it, it's for nothing. It's for show. Sometimes I may not act. Let me see how to word this better. I probably should have just read it. But, sometimes I may not act like people think Christian folks or church folks should act. I don't. Sometimes I might not. But I said to myself, I said, self, would you rather look saved or would you rather be saved? Would you rather be on the straight and act like you seem like you're on the straight and narrow? Or would you rather be on the right path? Would I rather act redeemed or would I rather be redeemed? God knows this world needs a lot of things, y'all. But what he needs is for us, the people inside this room, to get back to Jesus. Can y'all just say Jesus with me? Jesus. That's what we need. All the theatrics and fireworks and all that stuff. Look, man, if that gets somebody's eyes pointed this way, that's great. But they need Jesus in the end. We don't need the acts. We don't need the gimmicks. Jesus needs to be the center. We need to act like he's the only way because there is only one way. We all know salvation comes not by works, but by faith, right? Galatians 2:16 says that. Isn't that great? Isn't that great that we don't have to work for it? Isn't that fantastic? The best part about that is it's true. But please remember who you need to have the faith in. It is by faith. Faith in Jesus. You can have faith in a lot of things, but the faith that brings salvation, the faith that brings healing, I said the faith that brings change only comes from Jesus. It's so easy to get sidetracked, and Kenny's going to talk next week about being busy, but I'm cutting stuff out for you, brother, I am. But if you go to a church that isn't built on Jesus, I'm going to tell you, you're going to the wrong church. If you have a plan to reach the lost and Jesus sitting in the center of it, it's not going to work. It will not have long-term effects. I'm telling you it won't. If you're reading some kind of new doctrine and Jesus isn't the Word that became flesh, he's not the Son of God, if Jesus isn't the Most High, the Alpha, the Omega, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, you don't have to explain the doctrine to me. I don't want nothing to do with it. Give me Jesus. I only want Jesus. Guys, I've had enough of the Word just being watered down to fit. I have had enough of just tiptoeing around the truth with limited results. We need Jesus. The world needs love, comfort, and forgiveness, and truth that only comes from Jesus. You know, a lot of people try to mix the old and new versions of themselves. You're going to be miserable. If that's you, you're gonna be miserable. The old has died, and the new, right? You have to become new. They know who the Savior is. They know who the Savior is, but they try to be as close to the world as possible. If that's you, I can tell you that you're probably just close enough to be out of the voice of God. You won't hear the sound of his voice. You're probably just close enough to be on the outside of the conviction of the Holy Spirit. Now, if you're a man of God or a woman of God and you don't have the conviction of the Holy Spirit, you have a tough road ahead. When Jesus went away, he gave us the Spirit as help. He's our helper. He walks with you. I'm going to tell you guys, without the Holy Spirit, I would not be who I am. I would probably be who the world, who I was supposed to be. I'm going to do that. Who I was supposed to be. I wouldn't be up here talking to you guys because I would have leaned on my understanding a long time ago. There's a lot of things as a Christian that don't make sense to me. It doesn't. I'm not going to get into it. But I know the love of Jesus, and I know he loves me. One day, the problem is we're natural. He's supernatural. And, you know, one of my best friends, I hadn't seen him as much as I'd like to the years before, but I think it was last year. One of my really good friends, who I thought of like a brother, he died at 49 years old. Now, I did part of his eulogy. I'm trying, guys. This wasn't in my notes. You know what? I'll save that for another time. But there's no substitute for Jesus Christ. John 14:6. Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. There's only one way. Am I right? Is there only one way? You know the beautiful thing about that is it's available to everybody. It's available to all. Some of you have had hard lives. Some of you have dealt with more pain than anybody should have to in this room. Some of you have suffered more than anybody should have to. Some of y'all have just had a hard road. You know, I think the problem is some of you are just, you're so used to have the scratching claw just to stay above water. You're so used to having to struggle to earn everything you have that you may not understand how salvation is just free. It doesn't require you to do anything except accept Jesus as your Savior. I know I've said it before, and I'll say it again. I think it should be harder because it's so easy that we don't get it. You can be made new. You can be made new. I'm trying to look at everybody. You can be made new. I don't care what the world says. I'm not in the world. You can be refreshed. If you're already a Christian, you can be refreshed today. This world can only give you temporary happiness every now and then. But there is a huge difference between temporary happiness and the joy of the Lord. Imagine a seesaw. Y'all know I like imagine things, but imagine a seesaw. You on one side, the happiness of this world's on the other side, okay? And y'all just going up and down and up and down because that's what your life's going to be. You'll have highs, but your lows are coming. You'll have highs, but your lows are coming. All right, now imagine that same seesaw. And I'm on one side, and imagine a full-grown African elephant sitting on the other side. I'm up, right? I just stay up. The reason I stay up is because it doesn't matter what the enemy does to me. My happiness is not dependent on the world, the joy from the Lord. The enemy might better steal your happiness, but he can't take your joy. So you're just going to stay up. And I guess I just like elephants. That's why that came into there. And I know some of you are thinking like, yeah, he's not talking to me. I'm talking to y'all. He can't take your joy. Can't touch it. Todd, if y'all want to come up. You might be bound by sin, but you are free to worship God. You might be chained by addiction. Guys, I'm getting real today. You might be chained by addiction, but you are free to worship God. You might be a slave to what your own mind or circumstance has labeled you as, but you are free to worship God. Can I tell you that you're free to worship God? You're not stuck. You see, when you choose to exercise that freedom, chains break. Mercy just falls when you choose that freedom. Lives change, burden ends, and freedom begins, y'all. Freedom begins. You know, so today, if you need freedom, if you need joy, you won't find it at the bottom of a bottle. You're not going to find it from a stranger. You're not going to find it on social media. The only place that you're going to find the freedom and joy that's going to make your life full, the only place that you're going to be fulfilled, the only place you can find that contentment that's going to get you through every day is through Jesus. So maybe, you know, maybe you're in here and you just never had Jesus in your life. You know, maybe I'll go a step further. Maybe you've raised your hand for salvation and just didn't really get it. I hope that what I explained today kind of helped you understand that we are an imperfect people. And the thing about it is we're going to be an imperfect people. And I said it last time, we're not sinners because we sin. We sin because we're sinners. Don't put an expectation in your mind that you can't reach. Make sure that you're following God's expectation. You never fail when you're in God's will. When we are in our will, we'll always fail ourselves. I think I can do anything. God takes me back down and says, this is what I want you to do. Amen? I mean, does anybody else feel like that? I thank God for the abilities that he's given me. I thank God for the love that he's given me for my family. There's something to be said about that contentment. I am full. And there's a lot of you here that might be empty. I am full. It's not free. It doesn't come easy. I work on that every day, but I am full. And I know there's people that need that feeling. I'll say it one more time. The only way you're going to get it is through Jesus. It's not going to be religion. It's not going to be some book that you found. It's going to be through Jesus. So if you need Jesus today, if you've never accepted Jesus in your heart, today is your day. Not tomorrow. You're not going to find it anywhere else. Today's your day. And I want you to know we're not going to single anybody out. We're not going to push anything on you. Your relationship with God is just that. It's your relationship with God. I just have to know that you have one. I don't want to know the ins and outs. Now, if you come to me with help, I'll help you. But I don't need to know. If somebody comes to me and starts to tell me something about you, guess what I do? I don't need to hear it. I don't want to know. I just want to know that you know him. I'm trying to simplify this as much as I can, guys. We need Jesus. We don't need anything else. I know a lot of you probably are like, yeah, Adam, you said it 100 times. I need y'all to get it. We need Jesus, guys. So if you need Jesus in this place, I'm going to give you an opportunity in a second to accept him. Or you can do it right now without me. It's not me that's going to decide that. But other people, if something I've said today has touched you, if you realize that, you know, maybe you're not where you want to be as a father, it can happen today. I believe that God can do anything. And I think that he will today. Guys, I know that somebody had to hear what God gave me today. There was just too much resistance. And I don't want this moment to pass, or I don't want this day to pass, this right now. If you have a heartstring pulling, man, just listen to it. Listen to it. Guys, we need Jesus in this place. I hope none of y'all settle for anything else. I hope none of y'all settle for anything else but Jesus. Anyway, I'm going to pray. Can everybody kind of just bow their head and close their eyes? God, if there's anybody in here, I pray that you would soften their heart, God. If there's anybody in here that doesn't know your love, God, that there's anybody in here that just needs a break. God, they just need a break. God, they want that full feeling. God, they've been broken for so long that they just got used to it. God, that is not normal. And I pray that you would put it on their heart right now that they need you. Now, I'm not going to need you to ask you raise your hand anything. If you need Jesus in your life today, just accept him right now. If you've had Jesus in your life before and you feel like you just need to sell out to him again, accept it right now. He's here. Church, really simple. As a group, can we just say Jesus? I love you. I know you love me. What you did, giving your son for my freedom, I appreciate. I love you for it. I accept you as my Lord. I accept you as my Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so guys, look. If one person just accepted God, I'm telling you this, it's something amazing. Anybody else? Kenny, are we doing the prayer team? Would a prayer team come up real quick? Just like I want you guys to not forget to pray for your pastors, I hope that y'all understand how powerful prayer is. And there's no... God, I feel like the enemy has chains on us, thinking that there's something shameful about needing prayer. As a man that accepts, I need prayer. I can't do it by myself. Look, God, these people up here, they love you just as much as Jesus does. I'm just joking. Jesus loves you more. But no, what I'm getting at is these people love you and they care about what happens to you. And there's something about sharing. Well, we want to keep everything bottled up, especially if it's some kind of sin. But you know, the Bible says that if we... share our sins with each other, what's going to happen? We're going to be healed. Not from him, from us. These people have faith that Jesus is going to meet you where you are. So if you have any need, if this message had a need, pulled you in any kind of way, I need you to just, you're welcome to come up and get prayer. Now, if you're scared of coronavirus, sometimes people are scared of coronavirus. You don't have to, but you have that option. If you have any need, if you want to stand in the gap for somebody that you know needs Jesus, and you want to, today, we can start a group believing that they'll come. And it ain't about coming to church. I'm talking about coming to Jesus. So with that being said, if anybody has a need, y'all come up. If not, man, I hope y'all enjoy the rest of y'all Father's Day. I know I will. Thank y'all.
Will you meet me here again? God, we give you thanks and praise for this glorious day to be able to get together and share our love for you and for giving you thanks for what you've done for us. Not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here again? It's all I want, it's all you are. Will you meet me here again? Not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is what you are. Will you meet me here again? From the worship team, we want to wish you all a very, very glorious day. Happy Father's Day to all you fathers out there. Be loved, be kind, be fruitful, but most of all, as Adam said, be there. We love you. Have a great weekend. We'll see y'all next week.
First of all, man, Adam, awesome job. Man, that message was great. And I just want to add something right quick, you know, because that song right there gets me. It gets me, y'all. So from Janae on this side to Mr. Eric and Miss Tanya in the back over there, Tillman and his family over here, guess what? Every last one of y'all are enough,
yes.
Right? Don't ever think that you're not enough, yes. All right? Because the moment that happens, guess what? You're letting that devil win. Don't let him win. Don't give up. Keep fighting the good fight, right? Mm-hmm. Now, next, ooh, almost had me tongue twisted. Man, y'all really think about that. Having a choice, you know, you have a choice to worship freely. With that being said, man, if you want to practice it, get in your car, turn the radio all the way up like I do. Put your windows down, just turn the radio all the way up and just sing along with it. Because guess what? You don't need to worry about how the next person feels about your voice, right? Because guess what? I can't sing, but I will die trying, right? Man, because guess what? He didn't give us all that gift, but he gave us all the opportunity to do it, right? So just continue to worship freely, you know? Let everybody know what your God has done for you. Like he said, encourage, you know, encourage one another. Dude, y'all, encouragement goes a long way. And guess what? It starts within you, right? Because you have to be self-encouraged to go and encourage someone else. And guess where you get yourself encouraged from? You get it from Jesus, right? Your Father.
Yeah.
And guess what? He's not going to lack on it, y'all. He's going to give it to y'all. Y'all just have to believe in it and have faith, right? Next thing is prayer cards and praise reports, y'all. I went over them. They're all there in the back over there in the little center right here. I encourage each and every one of y'all, like, if there's a prayer need or a praise report need that you may have forgot today, man, on your way out, fill out the cards. Put it in the little basket. We will get to them. We will pray on them daily. I just read each and every last one of them, y'all. There is so many needs for health, for families, reuniting family members, prayers for our small groups, y'all, for our small groups to have breakthroughs, not only here but in the whole community. Y'all, we can do it. Right? Because guess what? Another thing, revival. Y'all, the revival is coming.
Yes.
But we have to be ready. Yes. We have to have revival in our hearts. Yes. Ready to go out there and just express our emotions and our joy and happiness that he's given to us.
Yes.
Right? So, man, I highly encourage y'all to continue to fill out those praise cards. Because guess what? They get prayed on daily, y'all. Daily. We have a big prayer group here. We don't only have a prayer group here, but we have a prayer group online for you. If you can't fill out a card here, please go online to the prayer group and put it in there. we will pray for it. We are a church that stands on prayer first. Man, thank y'all for coming, y'all. I just want to pray y'all out today and just continue. Y'all just continue to have a great Father's Day, and not only just that, but a great Sunday with your families, and just enjoy and love on them, y'all, like he has given us. Lord, we thank you today, Lord, for just giving us this opportunity, Lord, giving us this place, first of all, Lord, to be able to come in and worship you freely. Lord, we thank you for that message that you put on our brother's heart today, Lord, that he was able to share with us. Lord, that we can go out there and we can learn how to encourage one another, Lord, and just continue to be your vessel. Continue to work for you. Continue to know that we are building your kingdom, Lord. And, Lord, we just ask that you just continue to just pour that self-encouragement on us, Lord. And, Lord, I ask that as all these individuals walk out of here, Lord, and go out into this world, Lord, that you just protect them, Lord, that you just share a hedge of protection over them and their families, Lord. And we just thank you and we give you all praise, honor, and glory. Amen. See y'all next week.